Today, we have a very special guest joining us. Many of you know him as a funk icon, extraterrestrial, and Afrofuturist. But he has also recently dabbled into the visual arts as well, to extend how we understand and celebrate the funk even further. His distinguished career spans many different sectors of the arts and culture, including music, production, writing, performing, and now adding the visual arts to his list of expertise. Ladies and gentlemen, I know you are all excited as I am. Please join me in welcoming our guest for today, Mr. George Clinton.
How you doing? Thanks for that build up there.
Mr. Clinton, the museum is very excited to have you as a guest today. For those who don't know, the National Museum of African American Music, or as we like to call it, NMAAM, recently opened an exhibition in our feature gallery titled Boundless. The exhibition features pieces created by Mr. Clinton himself, who during a worldwide pandemic known as COVID-19, found new ways to pioneer artistic expression through creating some of the amazing pieces we have on display at NMAAM. Each of those pieces are reflective of the psychedelic, soulful sound and boundless nature of funk. Now, before we jump into our conversation, let's set the stage. Lyrical artist Langston Hughes once wrote, "An artist must be free to choose what he does, certainly, but he also must never be afraid to be or do what he might choose." Mr. Clinton is an artist who has shared multiple sides of himself with the world, and it is our duty to celebrate and preserve the funkadelic experience he has cultivated for all of us. Now, we have a limited amount of time and a wealth of knowledge available through Mr. Clinton. Let's jump right in.
I'm down. I'm ready.
Okay. Mr. Clinton, our audience has seen, enjoyed, and celebrated your funkadelic creations, both musical and artistic. But the way they see and understand you might be completely different from how you see and understand yourself. So let's begin there. Who is George Clinton and what do you do?
Oh, George Clinton is an artist. I like to make music, and I'm finding out that being an artist, you have more than one way to get that out of you. So visual art has become a part of that artistic part of George Clinton, the funkadelic, the P-funk, the mothership connection, Afrofuturism, psychedelic. And I'm finding out that once you got that bug in you that you want to create, it comes out in all kinds of ways. And it's probably been coming out that way all along. I just didn't know it because as I try to intellectualize being an artist, which is a big part of being an artist, is intellectualizing what it is and how you do it, blah, blah. I'm finding out that I'm finding new things out about myself. It's, you know, and while I'm trying to analyze it and come up with it, I'm seeing that being a visual artist is so much like being a musical artist. It's about the rhythms of the strokes. It's about the vibe that you feel when you feel like creating some. I have that same vibe of wanting to get up early in the morning and get to the studio to paint. And all of this came about because of the pandemic. Mm-hmm. I mean, I found out who George Clinton is lately for myself just by having to intellectualize what makes me want to paint. When did I start painting? I'm colorblind, so I had to analyze how do I do it, not knowing what colors it is. And, you know, and like I said, when you try to intellectualize that, I'm finding out who George Clinton is myself, you know, going through that. So talking to you is going to bring stuff out of me, you know, because like I said, that pandemic, I did 2 years of being in this studio making paintings, because I knew when I come out, I wanted to have something to show for all that time I spent. And in doing that, it's been very nice to me.
I always felt like when I saw your artwork, you were talking to us during this pandemic. And I appreciate that conversation. And I feel like folks, when they see your artwork, they are appreciating that as well.
Like I said, I'm appreciating it because I had to analyze it when I got an art manager and started doing these art shows and things. I found out the most important part of that is intellectualizing it and being able to explain. Otherwise, I'm doing what I feel just like I do when I'm on stage. I don't have a clue what I'm getting ready to do on stage when I get up there. I just turn the funk on, and wherever it takes me, I follow. I trust my funk. I trust my rhythm. So it took me a minute to trust the art when it started becoming serious. You know, I got art teacher, who do our album covers, Overton Lord, Pedro Bell. You know, those are artists to me, I consider myself doodling until all of a sudden it started becoming serious. And I start feeling that same feeling that I get when I get a good groove, and I'm got that pocket going on the stage. I got that same feeling in this art world now. So I'm loving having to explain this. And so I learned what I'm talking about as I go along.
Yeah, that was gonna be my follow-up question about why did you shift to creating artwork?
Well, like when the pandemic happened and everybody had to shut down, most people was bored, stiff, didn't have nothing to do. I welcomed it because, first of all, I'm getting ready to retire from the road, and it shut us down just before I finished the tour. So I had to come back home and start doing something. And I realized right away, this is going to be fun being shut down. I ain't got to worry about getting up going to nowhere. Nope. And I can just paint. And I had something that I felt good enough that, wow, nobody's going to believe this when this pandemic is over. I'm going to have so much work because I was getting up, like I said, early in the morning, all day long. And it was just getting good to me. After all these years of just doodling and dabbling in it, this was a whole plan. Mm. And once I did that, I had to get an art manager spring, and take it serious. So, yeah, and that's how it got so serious. It was the pandemic locked us in that room, and I made up my mind I was going to come out of there with something serious.
It's interesting that you say serious because when you said trust, I had to trust my funk. I was thinking, man, he's really talking to us right now. And he's really talking about individuals in society, about trust and what's inside them. So this is my question. What should all emerging art creatives who are watching this interview strive to do or achieve through their work?
I'm going to tell you the same way I tell when people ask me about the funk and all that, and how do I know when it's working? How do it work? And to me, it's do the best you can and then funk it.
Mm.
Let go. Let yourself do. Trust yourself. If you're doing the best you can, that's all you can do. And if you do that, that positive feeling of being, I've done the best I can, comes out in the final work. So I think anybody, do the best you can and let go. Use the force, Luke, as they say in Star Trek, Star Wars.
And I love the fact that you're an example of how the force happens at any different point in your life and throughout your life.
Anytime, especially when you're in trouble. And like you say, you do the best that you know and be sure that you've done the best you can. Don't be lazy. Once you've done the best you can, and you ain't got to feel guilty after that. You ain't got to feel no kind of way. Once you've done the best you can, you're not guilty of nothing. That's all you can do. You can get in your own way after that, because when you force it past that, then you actually getting in the way.
Okay.
Have you done the best you can?
So I think you've already started talking to us about that, about the process. One, get out your own way, right? But I'd like to hear more about what is your creative process? Does your creative process stem more from putting your heart and soul in your work, or letting your mind flow freely and losing yourself, as they say, in the funk?
I think it's the latter. I think it's the latter. I think it's putting myself in the situation and then losing myself, let myself go. Because intellectually, and I don't even know what I'm doing it, you know, like that, but I trust what it is in me that creates and take me those places. This, and I keep referring to music because I don't know what I was doing musically. You know, I know how to make a record. I know how to sing, but being able to break that mold and go someplace different than normal, I have to let myself go and trust that my inner funk take me there. I have to trust that. And that's what happened with the art. I get up and go down there and put the canvas on. I might do something just to provoke myself to get started, you know, like throw some paint on the canvas and see where it lands and take off from there, following where it lands and pick up and make whatever I'm going to do from that. I don't have no pre-plan, nothing. But as I started working, I get that groove, or as they say in sports, you get in that zone, everything you do start feeling right. You know, once you're in that zone, and I just trust that. And as I educate myself on all the different artists over the years, now that it's become serious, I see the pattern that other people use to get themselves started. I pay attention to that. But in the meantime, I just, like I say, one thing I have to do, because I'm colorblind.
Okay.
I have to, you know, write the colors on the markers are on the cans, you know, so I know what color it is. And I'm fine with that. I know where they're at. So I ain't really got to worry about too much colors. I can, you know, because I got them situated. Now, my grandkids will come in sometime and switch the name from, you know, the orange or the pink to the just. And the only time I realize it when they start laughing at me, you know, somebody, you see a yellow dog or something. Okay, but then I can blend it because also was a barber. So I know how to shade, even if it ain't color. I can shade, blend from thinning it out with white, any colors, and make it look all right no matter if it's a clashing color. So all those kind of things I can use to get that, how you said, the technical stuff out of the way. Because as long as it feels good to me, it's all right.
I like how you're describing exactly why we titled the exhibit Boundless, because you're not allowing anything to hold you in. The idea of not allowing anything to hold you in makes me think of the resiliency and the creativity and the innovation that we celebrate often with African-American culture. And funk music represents that to us. But it's important to understand how these characteristics within funk music connect to your artwork as well. So with that said, how did the inspiration you receive as a musician transition into working as an artist? And I'm really, you talk about getting into that groove, getting, you know, submersing yourself into the funk. But I'm thinking, did you listen to music while you were creating? And what was it like?
Well, that's twofold, because I definitely listen to music. And what's happening for the last couple of years, I've been legally getting my music back, copyright recaptures. I've been going through the legal thing, getting all my music back. So I've been celebrating that, getting it back and re-owning it. So getting re-familiar with songs that I just obtained back after 50 years, I listen to those. And it gives me an inspiration as I'm dancing my way out of my constriction.
Yes.
You know, that's the strokes. And the same thing with funk is a lot of colors in it. Like, mm-hmm. I'm colorblind, but the vibe of, of frequencies is still there. So whether I can see it or not, I can feel it, you know, once I get in that thing. And the tones, you know, not being able to see the colors themselves, I can tell the dark from the light and the shades. So I can play those all day long. They're the same tones that you have in music.
Yeah.
You know, and I guess, and it just works so easy once I started relating them to each other. And the lexicon, you know, the strokes, that is so much like, you know, your ability to sing or play an instrument, your style. So I learned all of that in the painting. Oh, that's the same as if I was beating on my legs. And you know, you get all of those strokes, and that has its own rhythm, its own language. And I mean, I'm teaching myself all of this right now.
Right. That's being a lifelong learner, huh?
Yes. Oh, yes.
So tell me, do you have a favorite piece? I mean, the collection is 38 pieces of artwork, and it must be hard, but do you have that standout piece?
Well, a couple of them. I have a couple of them like that. Right. I mean, I've got over 500-600 pieces.
Okay.
You know, they're stacking around, and as I go back and look at some of the ones I've done maybe 10 years ago, I forgot all about that. Keep changing once I see ones that I haven't seen in a long time. But lately, having to put pieces in the museum and a few shows that we're doing, I ran across some that I had forgotten about, but I have a few that I'm partial to.
Okay. At the National Museum of African American Music, we have a tagline, One Nation Under a Groove. Beyond our mission and vision, this line centers all the work we do in celebrating and preserving the American soundtrack for all to enjoy. What role do you hope the museum will have in preserving African American music, culture, and educating the world on the many ways it has and continues to influence us? Again, One Nation Under a Groove.
Well, you know, that's that music, the funk, One Nation Under a Groove, all was celebrating. We're the backdrop for a lot of people's life. You know, we're the backdrop to their life story, to the, you know, the culture. For the last 35, 40 years, the funk and One Nation Under a Groove especially was the backdrop to that. And we're celebrating that. I'm glad that there's a Afro-American museum Afrofuturism. I'm glad that came about as a concept, because we have always thought of ourselves as being blacker than black. Even though, and that in doing that, we actually enjoy playing to the whole world,
mm-hmm.
not only black, everybody. But by being ourselves, ultimately being ourselves, doing it, overdoing it. I mean, we tried not only to be funky, we tried to be that old New Orleans and Mississippi mud funk. We tried to get wallow in it, because that's basically the DNA for all the rock and roll,
yeah.
all the R&B, all the pop music of this country. Yeah. Now, and funk is definitely the DNA for hip hop, which is the ultimate music of the world right now, you know. So I just go ahead.
I have to say that you did that. You anchor us. You hold us where you're reaching for the future, and you're pulling back from the past and letting us know that we got something to build off of and appreciate.
And we say funk is the P funk. We call it pure funk.
Yeah.
You can put a 10 on it, it'll still be funky. You know, it's only one, you know.
Yes. There are so many different lyrics you intertwine in your songs that I know folks carry with them. I know that we talk about this when setting context, how important it was that you were talking to Chocolate Cities and those cities that needed to hear something uplifting from you, and they got that. I know that when I teach, I often talk about how you go and you pull back from those old spirituals that many of us grew up on. And then we get excited when we're in the club and hear that beat, that very same song in hip hop. I mean,
Right.
again, it raises us. It
Like
raises.
I say, it's the DNA that we brings along with the funk. We always try to keep that DNA of that Black experience, in the music, and
And you're demonstrating why this matters. So I'm going to take you here. We always say this saying at the end of many of our interviews, discussions, etc. And so I'm going to ask you to repeat after me and finish the sentence. My music matters because.
it's the funk. It's got to matter. It can't help but matter. Funk is its own reward. My music matters because it's its own reward.
Oh, I appreciate that. And with that, ladies and gentlemen, we've reached the end of our interview. I'd like to thank.
Want to talk some more. I want to funk some more. I'm
Right.
just getting started. One thing about the funk is long.
It's long, right? Y'all need to keep clapping so we can stay on stage. You
Okay.
know? But again, Mr. Clinton, thank you for joining us and all of you watching as well. Please keep up with us through all of our social media channels at the NMAAM for updates and upcoming program announcements. And also, the Boundless exhibition is open now at the National Museum of African American Music. And we invite all of you to come out and witness the brilliance that is Mr. George Clinton. Thank you again, and have a wonderful rest of your day.
Cool. And check out georgeclintonart.org. Roof.
Thank you.
Cool.